There are different types of renal disorders, some of which you have to study are renal failure, renal hypertension, nephritis, nephrosis, and renal calculi. Renal failure is a condition when the kidneys are no longer able to filter and clean blood. So this will lead to the accumulation of unsafe levels of waste products in our body fluids. And this is also called as end-stage renal disease or ESRD. There are two types of kidney failures. They are acute, which occurs all of a sudden, and chronic, which develops over time. Acute renal failure occurs when the kidneys suddenly stop filtering waste products from the blood. So what are the common reasons for acute renal failure? It can be a low blood flow to the kidneys, which can happen after a complicated surgery, or sometimes from an accident, if there are lesions occurring in the kidney, or if there is a hemorrhage in the person's body and the kidney is not getting enough blood supply, that can lead to acute renal failure. Or as a reaction to a drug or infection, if the kidney undergoes inflammation, it can lead to acute failure. Then blockage of kidney function by a kidney stone, that leads to renal failure. High blood pressure, as well as certain other factors such as mercury poisoning, fatal snake bites, all can lead to acute renal failure. But if the cause is treated, the kidney can return to normal condition in the case of acute renal failures. The signs of acute renal failure is swelling of hands, feet and face. It is due to the accumulation of fluid, and this condition is called as edema. Then internal bleeding, confusion, seizures, coma, abnormal blood and urine tests, high blood pressure. These are the symptoms of acute renal failure. Then coming to chronic renal failure, this is a permanent loss of kidney function, which is characterized by the abnormal reduction in the number of nephrons inside the kidney, because this develops over time. It's not a sudden reaction. And the common causes are, again, high blood pressure, chronic glomerulonephritis, which is a kind of inflammation in the kidney which leads to damage of the kidney. Then high blood sugar or diabetes can lead to kidney damage over time, polycystic disease of the kidney, blockage of urinary tract, and certain kidney infections lead to chronic renal failures. Unfortunately, the symptoms appear only until the kidney function declines to 20% or less. So when 80% of kidney function is getting lost, symptoms may not appear. The symptoms appear only until the kidney function declines to 20% or less. So at this stage, certain signs will appear. First one is edema, again, which we saw in acute renal failure. That is the swelling of body parts like hands, feet, face, etc. due to sodium and fluid retention in the tissues. Then acidosis of the body fluids, acidosis of the blood. The blood is normally alkaline in pH, but in chronic renal failures, there can be accumulation of beta-hydroxybutyric acid and acetoacetic acid. Second one is that low filtration of blood will lead to the accumulation of H plus ions, which will contribute to increased acidity of the blood. Then the reduced production of ammonia, phosphates, etc., which are buffers of the blood. This can also lead to acidosis of the blood. Then marked decrease in the alkali reserve in the blood. These are all factors which contribute to acidosis. Then the other symptoms of chronic renal failure are abnormal blood and urine tests, shortness of breath, high blood pressure, coma, seizures, headaches, muscle twitches and cramps, yellow or brown skin color, itching. Now the diagnosis. So usually kidney failure is found out with the help of a blood test called as creatinine test. And creatinine is an end product of muscle metabolism. It is one of the waste products that is eliminated through the kidney. So when there is high creatinine levels than normal in the blood, it indicates lower functioning of the kidney. Now coming to the treatment modalities. Acute renal failure is treated by treating the cause, because I told you it is developing suddenly due to some reason like a snake bite, accidents, hemorrhage, post-operational problems, etc. Suppose if high blood pressure contributes to renal failure, and if blood pressure is treated, or if kidney stone has contributed to acute renal failure, and if it is treated, or high blood sugar. So if the cause is treated, acute renal failure can be cured to a certain extent. Sometimes a dialysis for a short time may be needed. In the case of chronic renal failure, treating the cause like high blood pressure, high blood sugar, etc., can only slow down the disease, But finally, if left untreated, this CRF can lead to end-stage kidney disease. When the kidney function falls below 10% of normal, the patient will definitely require a dialysis. That means dialysis which is required for his lifetime, or a kidney transplant will be needed, because the symptoms appear only when the kidney function is around 20% remaining. So the person definitely have to undergo either lifelong dialysis or a kidney transplantation. And if not treated, it will lead to high levels of urea in the blood, which is called as uremia. It is the buildup of high level of urea in the blood, and that will lead to other symptoms such as nausea, itching, etc. So when such symptoms appear, it is an indication of uremia, that is a buildup of high urea level in the blood, and this can be taken as an indication, tested for renal failure, and dialysis can be suggested, or the person can go for a kidney transplant. Now we go to the procedure which is called as dialysis. It's a method of treating renal failure. In renal failure, the kidneys have stopped functioning. That is the function which they carry out by filtering blood to remove the nitrogenous waste from it. When the kidneys have stopped functioning, the blood cannot be filtered in a proper way to remove waste from it. So the patient's blood is passed through a device which is called as the dialyzer. And the dialyzer will do the function of the kidney, that is the filtering of blood. So what is the principle behind this procedure? Suppose you are separating a solution containing some crystalloid substances from water, from pure water, with the help of a semi-permeable membrane in between. So on one side you have this solution which is containing crystalloid substances, and on the other side you have pure water which is separated by semi-permeable membrane. Of course, these crystalloid substances, if they are able to cross the pores of the semi-permeable membrane, they will definitely move from the solution into water. So here in dialyzer, what happens is that blood is allowed to pass through minute pipes or channels which are made up of a membrane which is called cellophane. This cellophane is semi-permeable, and on the other side of the membrane, there is a fluid which is called as the dialyzing fluid, into which unwanted substances in the blood will pass by diffusion. So imagine two sides of the cellophane membrane. On one side, blood is flowing, and on the other side is the dialyzing fluid. So there is only a boundary in between, that is the cellophane membrane. So through this procedure, we will allow the waste substances present in the blood to cross the cellophane membrane and reach the dialyzing fluid. So that is how blood can be filtered. So it's a kind of diffusion process which is occurring from blood to the dialyzing fluid, and which are separated by a cellophane membrane. And cellophane is porous. It will allow the constituents of the plasma to move through it, except the plasma proteins. So the RBCs cannot also pass. So the blood will not lose the plasma proteins or the RBC. It will allow constituents of the plasma to move through it. Low molecular weight substances will be allowed to pass through it. So among these low molecular weight substances will be waste like urea, creatinine, uric acid, etc. And if the concentration of a substance is greater in the plasma than in the dialyzing fluid, so in one side you have the blood plasma or the blood, and on the other side you have the dialyzing fluid, and if a particular substance is of higher concentration in the blood plasma, that will definitely diffuse from blood to the dialyzing fluid. So this principle is to be kept in mind. That is, we will make the dialyzing fluid in such a concentration that it doesn't contain nitrogenous waste like urea, creatinine, uric acid, hippuric acid, etc. So what happens is that when they are separated from each other, all these substances which are present in the blood as waste, they will move through the cellophane membrane to the dialyzing fluid. But we have also to make sure that the blood will not lose low molecular weight substances which are useful to the body, like glucose. So the dialyzing fluid's concentration is adjusted in such a way that it will not take glucose from the blood. But its concentration is adjusted in such a way that it will take only the nitrogenous waste from the blood. So this is the basic principle of dialysis. So here you can see from the patient's artery, blood is taken, and this is passed through this part of the device which is called as a dialyzer. So this is the dialyzer, and in the dialyzer there is a cellophane tubing through which blood passes, and inside this dialyzer is the dialyzing fluid. So when blood passes through this tube, which is made up of cellophane, it is actually passing through a chamber which is containing the dialyzing fluid. So in this particular system, the blood and this dialyzing fluid are separated only by this cellophane tubing which forms the wall of this pipe. Okay, so inside this what happens is that the blood will from by diffusion, nitrogenous waste from the blood will pass into the dialyzer. Okay, so when blood comes out, it will be getting rid of the nitrogenous waste and then it is allowed to pass back into the patient's body through a vein. And we will go to the procedure now. So this is the basic principle. Now we will go to the actual procedure. So here we can see that fresh dialyzing solution is to be allowed to enter into this particular chamber. Otherwise, what happens is that once the concentration on both sides become equal, the process will stop. But we should not allow that. We want the blood to get rid of the waste. So the process to be continuous, we have to allow fresh dialyzing solution to enter continuously into this chamber. And used dialyzing fluid should be allowed to come out. Okay, so we are draining out the used dialyzed solution and we are also allowing fresh dialyzing solution to enter into this chamber so that the process can be kept always continuous. So the rate of movement of solute across the dialyzing membrane depends on certain factors. First thing is the concentration gradient of the solute between the two solutions. That means we have to make sure that the concentration of urea in the blood is always higher than that of the dialysate. Then only we can ensure its passage through the cellophane tubing. Second one is that the membrane should be permeable to these nitrogenous waste. Then only they will pass from the blood to the fluid. Third one is the surface area of the membrane. That means we have to allow blood to flow through this maximum space in the membrane. That means we maintain the tubing in a highly coiled manner so that the blood passes through a higher surface area through this membrane and we are giving more time for diffusion to take place. So the tubing will be highly coiled inside the dialyzing chamber. Then the length of time also. If sufficient time is given, then the nitrogenous waste will be removed from the blood. So the length of time that the blood and fluid remain in contact also matters. And this process in which the blood is getting dialyzed is called as hemodialysis. And this equipment is called as the artificial kidney. We can adjust the various concentrations. That is, the difference in concentration can be increased or decreased by optimizing the rate of flow of blood, the concentration of the dialyzing fluid, etc. So the factors are under our control. That means we can increase or decrease the flow rate of blood. We can increase or decrease the concentration of the dialyzing fluid, etc. Everything is under our control. And so the dissipation of the concentration gradient can be reduced. So the blood is collected from the radial artery of the patient. It is cooled to 0 degrees Celsius. And then it is mixed with an anticoagulant like heparin or coumarin or warfarin to prevent clotting of the blood inside the artificial kidney, and then it is allowed to pass through the dialyzer. And when the blood flows through the semi-permeable cellophane tubes, outside of the cellophane tube is the dialyzing fluid. So the entire setup is inside this equipment which is called as the dialyzer. And now we come to the constituents of the dialyzing fluid. In the dialyzing fluid, we can adjust the concentration of ions and other substances to certain levels, by which we can make sure that only appropriate movement of water and solutes across takes place across this membrane. That means we can adjust the concentration of ions and other substances in the dialyzing fluid so that whatever substances we want to pass through will only pass through. Okay, so in the dialyzing fluid, it is also ensured that there is no phosphate, urea, urate, sulfate or creatinine, because we want all these substances to diffuse from the blood to the dialyzing fluid. So the dialyzing fluid will lack all these substances: phosphate, urea, urate, sulfate, creatinine, etc. But in the blood, these substances are of high concentrations. So when the uremic patient is dialyzed, these substances are lost in large quantities into the dialyzing fluid. So that is how we make the dialyzing fluid in a suitable concentration. So the concentration can be adjusted so that only the waste will pass through, nothing useful is lost from the blood. So during this procedure, when the blood passes through the dialyzer, waste diffused from the blood to the dialyzing fluid across the cellophane membrane in a concentration gradient. And the electrolyte level of the blood plasma can also be controlled. How? By keeping the electrolyte level of the dialysate at the same electrolyte level of normal plasma. So in both the blood and in the dialysate, the electrolyte level will almost be the same. So there is no loss or gain of electrolytes from the blood. So that is another thing we have to keep in mind. Then if there are any excess plasma electrolytes, they will diffuse into the dialysate so that equilibrium will be established. So there will be no problem of any electrolyte imbalance. Then after the dialysis process, the blood which is coming out from the dialyzer is warmed to normal body temperature because it is now returned to the body, and then it is mixed with, so before returning it to the body, it is to be mixed with antiheparin, because we have already added heparin, so the blood loses its clotting ability. But one before it is sent back to the body, it has to regain its clotting ability. So to regain this clotting ability or coagulability, the blood is again mixed with antiheparin. Then only it will be allowed to enter into the patient's body again. So the blood is allowed to flow continually, or it is allowed to flow back into the patient's vein. So this process can be repeated again. And the total amount of blood in the artificial kidney at one time is usually less than 500 milliliters. Okay. Then in addition to the diffusion of solutes, we can also allow the mass transfer of solutes and water from the blood by applying hydrostatic pressure to force the fluid and solutes across the membranes of the dialyzer. So if you are exerting pressure and allowing more solutes and water to move out of blood, then that process is called as bulk flow. It is called bulk flow. Otherwise, the process will occur normally, following the principles of diffusion. If we are applying pressure to allow mass transfer of solutes and water from blood to the dialyzing fluid, then it is called as bulk flow. How can we express the effectiveness of the artificial kidney? It is expressed as the urea clearance rate. That is, in 1 minute, how much of blood plasma is cleared of its waste substances. So here, this is a normal value. That is, in 1 minute, about 100 to 225 ml of plasma is cleared of urea. That is how we measure the effectiveness of the artificial kidney. So this should be the normal range. That is, 100 to 225 ml of plasma should be cleared of urea per minute. The artificial kidney can function about twice as fastly as two normal kidneys together. Two kidneys work together, the urea clearance is only 70 ml per minute, but in the dialyzer or the artificial kidney, the urea clearance rate is about 100 to 225 ml per minute. That is about double the efficiency of two normal kidneys functioning together. But the problem is that the artificial kidney is not working throughout. One dialysis is of 4 to 6 hours duration in one day. Even though it has got high urea clearance rate, it is not performed throughout the day. It is only performed for around 4 to 6 hours per day. So this procedure need to be repeated. Maybe 3 times a week or 2 times a week this process is repeated. It is required frequently. Even though its clearance rate is higher than that of normal kidney, the procedure is to be repeated so as to ensure maximum filtration of blood and maximum removal of nitrogenous waste products. And in one day, the maximum duration is 4 to 6 hours, and in a week, this procedure is to be repeated at least 3 times. Significance of this procedure: it can purify the blood, it maintains the normal fluid and electrolyte balance of the blood. Suppose if the electrolyte level of blood goes high, then that will diffuse through the cellophane tubing to the dialyzing fluid and the electrolyte balance is regained. It can regain the efficiency of kidney in acute renal failures. It can also serve as a permanent solution for chronic renal failure, because if the patient continues dialysis lifelong, his life span can be extended. Then it is also a life-saving process during snake bite, poisoning with certain substances like mercury, barbiturates, salicylates, alcohols, heavy metals, etc. And this is also a routine procedure before and after kidney transplantation surgery. Before surgery, dialysis will be done, and after surgery also a dialysis will be done. It's routine. And this also is used for enhancing nutritional levels of blood by adding excess glucose to the blood from dialysis. So these are the significance of the procedure which is called as dialysis. It can purify blood, it maintains a normal fluid and electrolyte balance of blood, it regains the efficiency of kidney in acute renal failure, it is a solution for chronic renal failure, it's a life saving process during emergencies like snake bites, poisoning, etc. It's also a routine procedure before and after kidney transplantation and can also be used for increasing nutritional levels of the blood by adding excess glucose from the dialysate. First thing, we have to add anticoagulants to the blood which may affect the clotting ability of the blood. Second thing is that large quantity of blood need to flow from the patient's body through the dialyzer. Then only sufficient amount of waste will be removed. And this is a time consuming process also. As I told you, in one day the patient has to undertake this process for around 4 to 6 hours a day, and this procedure has to be repeated 3 times a week also, which is actually time consuming. So this is about hemodialysis.